Good evening, everyone. To welcome you to the National Constitution Center this evening, my name is Charlene Myers. I'm a professor of history at Rutgers Camden, and I'm the editor-in-chief of the Encyclopedia of Greater Philadelphia, and it's our great pleasure to be co-sponsoring the series of films of which this is a part. You know that the program we're having this evening is part of a continuing series of film and discussion programs titled to which we add a question mark in order to spur our thinking and creative engagement with the idea of equality and how it has manifested itself in American history. We are presenting these programs this year, 2015, as a commemoration of the 150th anniversary of the 13th Amendment to the Constitution, which ended slavery. This evening is especially fitting. The documentaries we showcase are films that have been produced with support from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the NEH. The programs are supported by a grant from the NEH and Gilder Lehrman Institute of American History. The local partners, in addition to the encyclopedia, are the African American Museum in Philadelphia, the Philadelphia History Museum, the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, and the National Constitution Center. By being here this evening, you're part of a discussion that's taking place in communities all over the country that are show documentaries that have been featured here in Philadelphia in this series as well. The documentaries are films that connect the stories of the long civil rights movement, from abolitionism to contemporary issues. And together they tell a remarkable story about the importance of race in the making of American democracy, about the power to effect change, and about the ways that Americans have understood and struggled with ideas of freedom, equality, and citizenship. And that's certainly the case of our film this evening, Freedom Riders. This is a film by Stanley Nelson that was produced in 2011 for the American Experience series. So this evening we'll be seeing excerpts from the film. We have a really marvelous panel discussion with two veterans of the Freedom Rides, as well as an expert in African-American history. And following our panel discussion, we will continue discussion among ourselves in the exhibit that the Constitution Center is now featuring, Creating Camelot, the Kennedy Photography of Jacques Lowe, which gives us a very different period in American history. So I think it will be fascinating to consider these contrasting images of the early 1960s. So before making further introductions, I'd like to invite our panelists and our moderator to join me on stage. Are we bringing everyone on now? Sure.
Is this right?
Okay. Let me see. So our panelists this evening will introduce in alphabetical order. We have Dion Diamond, who before joining the Freedom Riders was a physics major at Howard University. He was not a career civil rights activist, but a student doing his part. He rode the Greyhound bus from Montgomery, Alabama to Jackson, Mississippi as a part of the 24th, 1961. He, along with the rest of the bus riders, was arrested on their arrival to Jackson and sent to the Mississippi State Prison in Parchment. After his experience with the Freedom Riders, Dion served as the SNCC field secretary in Louisiana and Mississippi from 1961 to 1963. He was a member of the Nonviolent Action Group, NAG, in the D.C. 60 before his experience with the Freedom Riders. And that group worked to end Jim Crow laws in the District of Columbia suburbs in 1960. We also have with us this evening my colleague, Dr. Wayne Glasker, who's associate professor at Rutgers University in Camden. He specializes in African American history and 20th century United States history. The book Black Students in the Ivory Tower, African American Student Activism at the University of Pennsylvania, 1967 to 1990. And he's currently working on a new book about Malcolm X, James Baldwin, and the critique of colorblind integration. Also on our panel, another Freedom Rides veteran, the Reverend Reginald Green. At Virginia Union, Reverend Green participated in student sit-ins in Richmond, Virginia during the early 1960s. In 1961, he participated in the Freedom Rides, was arrested, and spent 29 days in Jackson, Mississippi's Hinds County Jail and the Parchman Penitentiary. After his release from jail, he met Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in Atlanta, Georgia. After of Walker Memorial Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., Reverend Green retired in 2006, but he has served as pastor of Jerusalem Baptist Church in Washington from 2008 to 2012, and currently serves as the interim pastor of First Rising Mount Zion Baptist Church, also in Washington. He was the first recipient of the district citywide award in 1976 for outstanding service in housing and community development for the citizens of the District of Columbia. Recently, in 2003, he was the recipient of the Pillar of Faith Award by the Howard University School of Divinity. Moderating our panel tonight, we have Curry Sautner. She is the Vice President of Visitor Experience and Education here at the National. She leads the Visitor Experience Team. She manages the museum's Annenberg Center for Education Outreach. So if you've been to the Constitution, you've been enjoying the fruits of her work. She also has served as an adjunct professor of education at Drexel University. So I'm very pleased to have the honor of introducing this wonderful panel to you, and I will turn the conversation over to Curry Sautner.
Thank you so much. So as we begin, I pause and say that this is absolutely, I'm like checking the moment here and saying what a highlight of my experience here at the center that I get to be on with these three brilliant, amazing people. If our conversation tonight is any reflection of the wonderful conversation we had back in the green room, it is going to be a wonderful night. Everything about the Constitution Center is all about this wonderful document that we understand, that we look at, and what holds our laws of our land together. But it's really about the undercurrent and the human beings that make those words real. The actions of the people on this stage and the research of this man right here really tell us the story of how this document affects our lives. And this is a great moment that we get to have, where we get to see an amazing film, and then instead of just watching people on screen that tell their story, we get to talk to them one-on-one in real time. So I feel very honored and very lucky. And as the person in charge of education here, I am every single day looking for ways to educate myself. So I'll be really excited about all the things that I learned tonight. Now, one of the things, I want to give you a little kind of housekeeping on the way we're going to do this tonight. We're going to have 10 clips of the show Freedom Riders. It is online at pbs.org, and you can watch it at any point in time and watch the entire thing. But tonight, we're just going to take three 10-minute clips, and we're going to intersperse them with questions. The first few questions will probably come from me and kind of pulling out the story behind the pieces. The third time when we ask for questions, we're going to be asking from the audience. So please, if there's anything that pops into your head, our staff is here, and they will give you white cards. Just raise your hand. Take a white card if you write down your question, and we'll ask those towards the end. But that is not it. This is like a grand night that we have. When we're done the conversation, the film screening, we're going to actually move downstairs to the Kennedy exhibit. The exhibits that we bring in here are always helping us tell a story, and I find this one very fascinating. It's telling the story of 1961 to 1963 in a very particular lens that were taken by Kennedy's personal photographer, and it's creating Camelot is the name of it, and that's really what it's doing. So what we do as educators here is we like to tell all the stories and understand very clearly what you all know is that you have to look at many primary sources happening during a time period. And if you look at one, it can be very, very one-sided and lots of things are different. And you don't know the whole story. So we'll be looking at those images down there, and we'll be having these other primary sources and a brilliant secondary source to really shape our understanding of that time period. And also, I ask all of you, if you have any stories, if you have anything to share, this is a community conversations together. So, sound like a deal? Plan? Okay, I'm very interactive, so I work with kids all the time, so I'm gonna point and ask you questions. So please hold me to that. So let's get started. So you've heard the bios of the Dr. Reverend Green and everybody on the panel, but let's hear a little bit about why they did this. So I was back there and I was talking to them, and mine is, what did your parents say? I mean, I would freak out if I heard my child wanted to be a freedom riser, and that's just panic, that's fear. But the answer that I got to that question was very different than what I expected. So Reverend, what did they say, and how did they find out? Because I think this is fascinating.
Good evening, and let me thank those who put on this program, because I think it's important that we hear as much as we can about time and the experiences of those whose memory is still intact, who can still share the stories about what happened in their experience as freedom riders. I was 21 when I was arrested on June. But my father had no idea that I had gone on the freedom rides. He discovered it through, in Washington, D.C., we had like two major newspapers, and one, the Washington Post was your morning paper, the Evening Star was your evening paper, and then we had a Washington Daily News, then of course we had the Afro-American newspaper and Pittsburgh Courier from the Black Press. And so those were the news media that no cell phones, no iPods, none of that. And so when the reporter found the names of persons and the where they were from, they contacted my dad, a story from my father about whether he had a son named Reginald Green. And he couldn't deny that. That would be blasphemous. But he found out through the reporter that, the reporter said to my dad, I need to come and talk with you to share some more information about your son. And when he got to my home on East Capitol Street Northeast in Washington, my father discovered then that instead of, as he told the reporter, about my working in Richmond, Virginia, because I was earning more money to return to school in the fall, did he find out from the reporter that I was in jail in Mississippi. Later, of course, get a letter. But in most of our letters we wrote, at least from my perspective, they were always addressed to the mother. And in passing would ask, tell Dad hello. Tell him everything's okay. And that's how he found out that I was in jail in Mississippi, in Hinds County, and then Parchment. But that's how it happened, how he discovered it. There's much more than that, but I'll just leave it at that. And when we come to some other questions, we'll deal with it mostly.
So thank you so much. That was great. Mr. Diamond, you were studying physics, is that correct?
Yes.
So, question for you, what was that that you felt that you had to go do this? What kind of spoke to you that said, I'm going to go do this, and I'm going to be a part of the Freedom Rides?
Well, prior to the Freedom Ride, I was a physics major at Howard University in the District of Columbia. And in 1960, prior to the Freedom Ride, the sit-in movement started in Greensboro, North Carolina, and spread throughout the South at mostly black institutions. But being at Howard in Washington, D.C., segregation was not the law, even though it probably existed. But we thought, why is it that we at Howard University, supposedly the epitome, the zenith in black education, were doing nothing? Well, if you went across the Potomac River into Virginia, we'd be in full fling. So about 10 of us Howard students decided that let's go over to Virginia and stage some sit-ins. The first sit-in was at a drug fair and People's Drug Store lunch counter. It took us 2 weeks after being surrounded by George Lincoln Rockwell and the American Nazi Party, spitting on us, taunting us, for the city to cave in and integrate not only the lunch counters, but the restaurants in Northern Virginia. As a result of that, and feeling flush, you know, with victory, we said, well, really next door, let's go to Maryland. There was an amusement park, which was on the outskirts of Washington, D.C. in Montgomery County, Maryland, and that didn't allow persons of color into the park. As I suggested previously, I think one of the main reasons was they did not want males of color in the same swimming pool as white males. That was one of the reasons they truly tried to keep the park segregated. At any rate, for that entire summer of 1960, we picketed and tried to get them to drop that policy of segregation. That's the summer of 1960. When the park closed for the summer, in the May of the following year, the Freedom Rides had already started, and I said, well, they have burned the bus in Anniston, Alabama, and they are about to stop the city, the Freedom Ride. I said, well, we can't allow. So I joined with a few others to pick up the ride. A lot of people from Nashville, Tennessee, a lot of people from other locations joined in the ride. Now, you have to understand something, please, because, quite frankly, people ask me, oh, you were a Freedom Rider. Did you know so-and-so? Now, quite frankly, initially, there were only two buses that went into Jackson. On each bus, there were about 13 or 14 of us. When we got arrested, we were divided into one set of cells, black males in another set of cells, white females in one set of cells, and white males in another. The only Freedom Riders that I ever knew were the people who were on the bus with me. With day after day after day, and bus after bus and bus, we didn't see them. So when people ask us, did you know so-and-so, the answer was probably no. There were 409 persons who were, approximately 409 persons who became Freedom Riders over a four-month period of time. As I said, I was arrested on the very first day that we got into Jackson, Mississippi. I think, as has been pointed, as a result of my thinking I was taking a long weekend, it took 2 years and change before I decided it's time for me to get back in school. I never got back to Howard, by the way. I ended up in undergrad school at the University of Wisconsin.
Still physics?
No. As a result of my exposure to Southern hospitality, I decided that I wanted to find out why did it take 100 years since the Emancipation Proclamation to find out why there was a concerted effort, an organized effort, to bring about desegregation. And I changed my major to American History and Sociology, Civil War and Reconstruction and Sociology. And that took care of my undergrad career. I might add, as a result of my exposure to the, quote, hospitality, you know how you apply for a federal job, or perhaps now almost any job? They ask of, have you ever been arrested? I put down, I've been arrested approximately 30 times. Please check with the FBI for dates and location.
Perfect lead-in to the historian of the group. So the question I have for you, and you can look back on a time period and look at all the materials and kind of use a modern-day lens to understand the impact. Can you give us a sense and a range of how much of an impact that the Freedom Riders and the sit-ins and the bus counters did society, but almost a global society, in changing the way we see protest and the way we see change?
Okay, well, let me say that prior to the Freedom Rides, most of America just wanted to ignore what was happening in the South. The country really did not want to know that there was segregation and that there was injustice. And we wanted to think that if you just will solve itself and we don't need to do anything. But when people saw, for example, the photograph of the bus being burned in Anniston, that was impossible to ignore. And I would add that the Kennedy administration wanted to ignore what was happening. but it's hard to ignore a photograph of a burning bus. And then the attacks in places like Birmingham and people being arrested in Jackson forced the nation to confront what was happening in the South. And I would add that the Freedom Riders were American citizens who were simply doing what they had the right to do under the Constitution. A Supreme Court decision had said that you cannot have segregation or involved in interstate travel. And this is interstate travel.
Commerce Clause, yay.
Exactly. and even the Supreme Court had said this, nevertheless, the South was violating the Supreme Court decision. It was not complying with the Supreme Court decision. So whose job is it to enforce the rulings of the Supreme Court? That's the job of the president. And the Kennedy administration didn't want to deal with this, but the Freedom Rides forced the Kennedy administration to pay attention to the issue and to actually take action to enforce the rule of law.
Perfect. Now, we're going to see the first clip of the Freedom Rides and really set up some of the experience. So I have always wanted to say, roll that footage, AV.
The reaction will be...
Our colored people will do exactly as they've done. Our white people, why? Because it's worked out best.
All-encompassing, this so-called Southern way of life, would not allow for any breaks. It was a system that was only strong, the white Southerners thought, as its weakest link. So you couldn't allow people even to sit together on the front of a bus, something that really shouldn't have threatened anyone. But it did. It threatened their sense of the wholeness, the sanctity of what they saw as an age-old tradition.
Travel in the segregated South for black people was humiliating. The very fact that there were separate facilities was to say to black people that blacks were so subhuman and so inferior that we could not even use public facilities that white people used. The Supreme Court even said that there was no right that white people had to respect.
You didn't know what you were going to encounter. You had night riders, Muslims. You could be antagonized at any point in your journey. So most of the time, it was very, very difficult. And, you know, you always had to meet someone to meet you there because you didn't know what to expect.
We're rolling along the highway. There is merry adventure in every wonderful mile.
We're gliding along the byway, lighthearted and free in streamlined style.
As we travel,
my father traveled quite a bit, and he just wanted a cup of coffee to make it to Montgomery, go around the back of the cafe to get a cup of coffee, and then they told him.
I'm sorry, I was to serve niggers in here.
Pushed them all out the door.
It's a wonderful, happy feeling, going along the broad highway. There's the open road in view, every month to make your trip a happy, thrilling thing to do.
I grew up in the South, child of good and decent parents. We had women who worked in our household, sometimes surrogate mothers. They were invisible women to me. I can't believe I couldn't see them. I don't know where my head or heart was. I don't know where my parents' heads and hearts were, or my teachers. I never heard it once from the pulpit. We were blind out of racism and afraid, I guess, of change.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
When John Kennedy was elected in November of 1960, there was great hope and expectation that things would be better on matters of civil rights. That was a contrast between him and Dwight Eisenhower. He was young and had ideas. He talked about the new frontier. But when he gave his inaugural address in January of 1961, he talked about spreading freedom all over the world, to China, to Latin America, to Africa, to everywhere but Alabama and Mississippi and Georgia.
The base of the Democratic Party was the essentially white voting South. The Kennedys had to be careful about antagonizing the whole Southern establishment, which was segregationist.
Oh, I was the first governor in the South that publicly endorsed him for president.
I think he's a person who is sympathetic to the problems and conditions in the South. I think he's a man who will work with us down.
I knew that you couldn't run for president on a segregation ticket. So I knew that. But I felt like that if we ever got some understanding and some help from the federal government in regard to our problems down here, that I'd get a good audience.
The entire nation will be looking at us on election day and will judge the way we feel about the segregation question by the size of the Democratic vote on November the 4th. Let's turn out the largest Democratic vote in the history of the state and show that we're not going to tolerate integration of the races one minute.
The Kennedys, when they came into office, were not worried about civil rights. They were worried about the Soviet Union. They were worried about the Cold War. They were worried about the nuclear threat. When civil rights did pop up, they regarded it as a bit of a nuisance, as something that was getting in the way of their agenda.
It became clear that the civil rights leaders had to do something desperate to get the Kennedys' attention. So that was the idea behind the Freedom Rides, to dare the federal government to do what it was supposed to do and see if their constitutional rights will be protected by the Kennedy administration.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friends alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
When John Kennedy was elected in November of 1960, there was great hope and expectation that things would be better on matters of civil rights, that it was a contrast between him and Hung and had ideas and talked about the new frontier. But when he gave his inaugural address in January of 1961, he talked about spreading freedom all over the world, to China, to Latin America, to Africa, to everywhere but Alabama and Mississippi and Georgia.
The base of the Democratic Party was the essentially white voting South. Careful about antagonizing Southern governors and the whole Southern establishment, which was segregationist.
Oh, I was the first in the South that publicly endorsed him for president.
I think he's a person who is sympathetic to the problems and conditions in the South. I think he's a man who will work with us down here to help us.
I knew that you couldn't run for president on a segregation ticket. So I knew that. But I felt like that if we ever got in a situation where we needed some understanding and some help from the federal government in regard to problems down here, that I'd get an audience.
The entire nation will be looking at us on election day and will judge the way we feel about the segregation question by the size of the Democratic vote on November the 4th. Let's turn out the largest degree of the state and show the people of this nation that we are not going to tolerate integration of the races one minute.
The Kennedys, when they came into office, were not worried about civil rights. They were worried about the Soviet Union. They were worried about the Cold War. They were worried about the nuclear threat. When civil rights did pop up, they regarded it as a bit of a nuisance, as some of their agenda.
It became clear that the civil rights leaders had something desperate, something dramatic to get the Kennedys' attention. So that was the idea behind the Freedom Rides, to dare the federal government to do what it was supposed to do and see if their constitutional rights will be protected.
I wish to apply for acceptance as a participant in CORE's Freedom Rides.
As we look at this, and as we talked about the Commerce Clause, we spoke about the Constitution needs to be in place. The Freedom Riders and the organization that is putting these young people into the South is calculatingly pushing the idea of crossing state boundaries, of really pushing these federal laws and making the federal state pay attention. But what was going on in the start off this way? The federal government was not paying attention. Where's that tipping point, that moment where things start to change? And this question is for you, sorry. I should have really wrote. Where's that moment where it goes from a few people willing to leave school, not tell their parents, and go and risk their lives to change things because they have to do something? Where does it go from the moment where the country starts paying attention and the government must pay attention?
Well, you know, of course, President Kennedy is doing a very delicate balancing act. I think that the firebombing of the really caught people's attention. And the Kennedy administration tried to stop the Freedom Rides. But then the second wave of young people from Washington, D.C., from Nashville, Diane Nash, that brought new life into the Freedom Ride. And the Kennedy administration could not stop them. And so for the media, as more and more people continue to get on the bus, continue to be arrested, and there continue to be racial incidents, I mean, the Freedom Riders were attacked in Birmingham. And Bull Connor pulled away the police to allow the Ku Klux Klan to attack the Freedom Riders. And so, there were examples in Japan who pick up a newspaper and it shows what's happening in Birmingham. The whole world learned about the Freedom Riders. And so the Kennedy administration could not ignore what was happening, especially because the young people continued all through the summer, more than 400 people all the way through August, to get on the buses, to be arrested, to push the administration to enforce the law. And what we're trying to do was to awaken the sleeping conscience of America, and to be more precise, to awaken the sleeping conscience of white America. And the Freedom Rides forced people to pay attention to what was doing and to put pressure on the Kennedy administration to enforce the law.
Now, thank you. That was perfect. Mr. Diamond, when you were there at that moment, did you see hope in Kennedy when he was first elected? What were your personal feelings on that angle?
Truly, I was hopeful. I mean, I... Kennedy had this image of, you know, vitality. He was from Massachusetts, liberal state. We expect him, but you hit on something that very poignant. President Kennedy, through his brother, the Attorney General, literally called Diane Nash on the telephone, sent his special assistant, not Bobby Kennedy's special assistant, Solfenthaler, really tried to get us to, the reason being, Kennedy was about to meet with Khrushchev. As you said, Kennedy wanted democracy to the world. How could he meet with Khrushchev and tell Khrushchev that, hey, you guys got to open up? When all of the segregation and I suppose I can only say that the resistance to integration in the South, he couldn't very well do that. But he tried literally to get us to stop, go home, And I think, I don't know, with my back to the screen, I don't know if that was Salt and Paula on the screen. Yeah. But at any rate, he got hurt. You know, our biggest salvation back then was the cameramen on TV. And they, all of a sudden, they were as much in peril as the Freedom Riders, because one of the segregationists knew that if their pictures were taken and spread all over the world, you know, they too could be prosecuted. But I mean, that's when I got disenchanted with the Kennedy administration, because obviously, I understand politics and you have to dance. You're a precarious dance in this particular situation, and unfortunately, he didn't dance the way we had hoped he would dance.
No, Reverend, and we're going to see this in the next clip that we look at and going to look very closely at what's going on with the cameraman as well. But, Reverend, you, when you go into the South and you're looking at the peril that you may be going into, and when you think about the federal government's job to protect the people, but also the police force, and how were your feelings about what all the police force when you were on the rides, and how was that experience very different than, and maybe the same as then when people see the police today? What was that like to see police that weren't there to protect and serve?
Well, it was this way. The three of us that were on the bus, the Trailway bus from Richmond, see, I left from Richmond, mm-hmm. Mississippi. And these were commercial buses we're talking about. They're not charter buses, this whole experience. So my group didn't really meet any activity or problem with going into Mississippi until maybe about 5 or 10 minutes from getting into Jackson. And they had, in those days, what we called transistors, not this fancy stuff. And you put it up.
Who knows what he's
anybody
talking
about? Anybody know what a transistor
is? Yeah, okay. I love
mine. And they had the mic on the bus that the bus driver communicated with the passengers. And you heard this voice coming across on the airway. There's some more Negroes and some more Negro lovers, some more of those so-and-so freedom riders. Now, these are airways we're talking about. Coming into jail, they can have a difficult time, or they can make it, or they can have it easier if they just acted like they should. The whole idea then is, of course, this whole position was jail, not bail. We just fill up the jails. And so the intent was go in, if you're white, you go into a color section, as they were referred to, or the Negro section in the bus station, or you went to the white section if you're African American, knowing that you weren't going to be served and you would be arrested. And it didn't take but a minute or so before you were arrested and carted out to jail and taken to Hinds County Jail, out to Parchman Penitentiary. So we didn't really see police force in terms, only until that sheriff came up and said, well, y'all can move now. You're not going to be served. You know you're breaking the law. And if you didn't move, then you were arrested. Happened in our case. The other thing I wanted to speak to, though, that you touched on earlier, and that is administration. You know, there's a kind of you know, close to a parallelism. Think about the Kennedy's reservation in trying to walk that tightrope to how he deals with, or in Khrushchev and the Soviet Union, versus these nuisance people called freedoms. How does he deal with that? It's almost like when Lincoln was facing with the breakup of the Union and was losing the war until it was finally discovered, in order for me to save the Union, then what? I've got to make sure that you can join forces. So the reservation of Lincoln in terms of, because had he been able to deal with the war, I think we may have a different story in terms of what happened in the Civil War era. Same thing with Kennedy, and that you had these students, many of them trained in nonviolence in Nashville, and a fellow named Jim Lawson, who was really who did musters of training then in Nashville, students from Tennessee State and the like, and we could go on and on. So they were the ones, because you knew now that you were at risk, even of death, if you went. And so those of us who have seen now what could happen were still willing to go on the ride, because you knew, number one, that you could get hurt, you could be maimed, you could be beaten, you could lose your life. But there was something about, Zion used the term youthful exuberance, he calls it. But my whole feeling was that pain for ministry, if that's going to be my field, then I must always understand ministry having a social context, that you can't talk religion and salvation without understanding social component to that. And that's what I saw going on with us. And that's why many of us did on the rides.
So we're gonna move on to our next clip that really talks about the violence that was happening and it really shows it. So let's check out our next clip. And then after that clip, I'm gonna turn it over to you because I think it's perfect timing for the audience to ask questions. So if you have any questions, raise your hand and our staff will pick them up.
Don't you know I am on my way?
The first group of Nashville riders make it back to Birmingham from the Tennessee border. There's a second already there. They've got a terrible problem. Jimmy Hoffa, the leader of the Teamsters Union, says, none of my drivers are gonna get on any of those buses. Greyhound Corporation can't find any drivers willing to get on the bus. So the riders are stuck there, and it's not clear how going to get out of Birmingham.
Mob grew into the several hundreds outside the terminal. Dozens of police patrol the area, and police dogs helped keep the streets clear and the mob back from the terminal. The Negroes went to board the bus finally, and the driver stalked off, saying he would not make the trip.
We were sitting in the white designated waiting room. This was my first encounter face-to-face with the Ku Klux Klan. They had on white sheets, and their hoods were thrown back, and they walked around in the bus station while we were there, and they stepped on our feet. They threw coal on our faces.
And he was getting frustrated. He gets word to John Patterson that if the state of Alabama won't protect the Freedom Riders, won't end this crisis, then the federal government would have to do it. They'd have to step in some way. Patterson realizes they have to do something. He says, can't you send somebody down to Montgomery to talk to my staff to figure this out? And that opens the way for John Siegenthaler down to Montgomery to talk with John Patterson.
I said, look, Governor, it's just this simple. You can't provide them protection, and you say you can't. You don't leave us any option. We'll have to provide protection for them. And it will have to be the U.S. Marshals or troops. But he turned immediately across the table and said, that's Floyd Mann, my commissioner of safety. Floyd, tell this man, these rabble-rousers are asking for trouble, and we can't protect them. He said, Governor, I've been in law enforcement. If you tell me to protect them, I'll protect them. It sucked the air out of the room.
Patterson's hands are tied because his chief law enforcement official has essentially said, I can protect the Freedom Riders in front of the Kennedy administration's representative. And so Patterson's in a position where he has to act.
Around 11 o'clock, I talked to Mr. Siegenthaler, and the governor at that time assured Mr. Siegenthaler that we have the means, the ability, and the will to protect these people. We will make sure that people traveling in interstate commerce and traveling across our highways are not molested, and traveling through our cities are not harmed. That's all I asked for. He said that they gave us his flat word and assurance that that would happen.
when we saw all the protection that we had, you know, we got relaxed then. We sung a few freedom songs, and as a matter of fact, I dozed off. That's right, felt safe.
Floyd Mann had state troopers leading them and following them. And we had a state trooper helicopter overhead, protecting them from overhead, and escorted them to the city limits of Montgomery, where we turned them over to the city authorities of Montgomery, who guaranteed to us that they would protect them and maintain order themselves at the bus station.
I was looking out the window, and I could see the policemen taking off in different direction, and so with the helicopter. And we were thinking that some Montgomery policemen was going to come in then, but then we didn't see anyone.
Pulled into the bus station. It was an eerie feeling. We didn't see anybody. We saw a couple of taxis.
Cameraman Maurice Levy, sound man Wee Risser, and I jumped out of our car to photograph the debarking from the bus itself. There was no large crowd around. I asked some of the riders what they intended to do. They said they did not yet know. Then a heavy-set man asked me whether I was one of the group. I said I was not. I noticed then that he was holding in his right hand an open penknife.
John was getting ready to go to the microphone, and just as he was about to do this, this fella went at one of the fellas that was holding one of the parabolic mics. And he grabbed it out of his hands and he threw it to the ground, stomped on it, and turned and approached one of the photographers and grabbed his camera and yanked on it, and in his doing so, the cameraman fell to the ground. He started kicking and beating him. And that seemed to be the cue.
The mob came out and went straight to them and started beating them and kicking them and throwing their cameras down, smashing them on the ground.
After we were forced away, that's when the attack on the riders themselves started.
It just seemed like, just suddenly, we were like, the bus.
You could see baseball bats and pieces of pipe and hammers and chains. And one fella had a pitchfork.
It was like it was a feeding frenzy, like you know how sharks are just, they were just crazy.
And what really sticks with me were the women. They were screaming, kill them niggas. And they had babies in their arms.
You could see baggage being thrown into the air. You could hear screams. My heart was in my throat. I knew suddenly betrayal, disaster, hope not death.
Bobby is getting this in real time as it's happening from his own lieutenants, saying something to the effect, it's terrible, it's terrible. He's watching it happen. There are no police, they're just beating them.
This was war. Parking lot. This was absolute war.
I asked God to be with me, to give me the strength I would need to remain nonviolent, and to forgive them.
The last thing I recall, standing with Jim Sverd, I was hit in the head with a wooden crate.
I heard a crack and fell forward. Rolled over on my back, and a foot came down in my face, and that was it. I was out.
William Barbee was knocked down. A big 250-pound white guy had his foot on his neck while another one was trying to drive a steel rod through his ear.
In their uniforms, just looking, they provided no protection for those students.
There is a skinny young kid, and he was sort of dancing in front of this young woman, punching her, and I could see, as she turned her head, blood from the nose and mouth. I grabbed her by the wrist over the hood of the car, had her right at the door, and she put her hands up on the door jamb. "Mister, I don't want you to get hurt. I'm nonviolent. I'm trained to take this. Please, don't get hurt. We'll be fine." And I said, "Get your ass in the car, sister." And at that moment, they wheeled me around and they hit me with a pop. They kicked me under the car and left me there.
There were from 300 to 1,000 whites in the area of the bus depot. Before police finally broke up the crowd with tear gas, they beat and injured at least 20 persons, races and both sexes.
After the Montgomery riots, the Kennedys are feeling betrayed. There's John Sigenthaler lying, and they realize that they can't work with Patterson, and they're going to have to bring in federal marshals.
The department says 400 United States Marshals will be in Montgomery tomorrow. They're being assembled from other southern states now, and court orders are being prepared for them to keep armed order if necessary.
We don't need the federal marshals here in this city. The situation here is well in hand, and if the outside agitators who came here and deliberately stirred up this controversy go home, and the marshals go home, it would be best for everybody, and the situation would return.
We're dedicated to this. We'll take hitting, we'll take beating. We're willing to accept death. But we're going to keep coming until we can ride from anybody else in the South.
So, I apologize that I moved during the film. I hope it wasn't too distracting, but I thought it would be a little, we'd try to change this up a little bit and do it a little differently. I think it's best when somebody asks a question to hear it from your own voice. Get the that way, and I'm sure, gentlemen, you don't mind at all. So what we're going to have to do is just, if you have a question, just please raise your hand, and Jen is going to come to you and hand you the mic, and you can ask your question to any of the panelists, and then we'll start from there. Do we have... Here, on. Okay, there we go. Oh, I can't tell which one it's mine because I have a mic on. That was intelligent. I know there's some questions in the back. I saw hands up, so you want to have
We had one written question.
Well, you can go straight to the back. We'll save this if we, there we go, right there.
When many of these freedom riders were injured by the police officers, were the hospitals, were they reluctant to treat them? Because some of these freedom riders were severely injured.
In some cases, the hospitals were very reluctant to receive the Freedom Riders. And in fact, in Anniston, the mob pursued them to the hospital and threatened them at the hospital. And so they then moved them to another hospital. And so it was very dangerous if you got caught in the middle. But the hospitals were very reluctant to Freedom Riders, which in reality is no surprise, given that you're in Mississippi and Alabama.
Hey, thank you. My question is, given that the heat of the battle, that you were nonviolent people, at what point in your lives did you come to appreciate fully the magnitude of what you endeavored and what you accomplished?
I think I continue to sort of marvel by what I see that demonstrates for me the impact movement largely of young, average age 19 of the Freedom Riders, though you had some older adults who were part of it, Jim Peck you just saw on the screen. So I still marvel at it. And thankful that there were enough students and persons who felt a feeling for a cause that was bigger than any individual, but could have lasting impact on transforming a nation and breaking down barriers that were in existence. So I'm still trying to digest or grasp it of what it is, because I don't think any one movement can define the progress that's been made. That's a major piece of it. Selma becomes critical. Bloody Sunday becomes critical. It leads to what? Voting in the Civil Rights Act, right? So all those things. So I marvel. But the thing I am very appreciative of is that whereas in 61, I saw no African-American person. Now, in Jackson, for example, the superintendent, Parchman, is African-American.
Female.
When I went back for the first time after the Freedom Rides, years later, the chief of police was African-American and a woman. And you had a chief of the Supreme Court in the state of Mississippi. So, and then when I see young people like persons, cameras, young people in school, doctors, lawyers, you name it, engineers, just to name, technicians, it makes me know that ordinary individuals in a at whatever risk they're willing to take help change this nation, and we to make sure this nation evolves into what King calls the beloved community. So I marvel at that, at what's happening. Thank you.
It is very difficult to watch that clip. Question, to your knowledge, was anybody ever brought upon charge for the attacks on the people in the Freedom Rides?
I can't respond to that. I truly you see, once we were incarcerated, or once we were arrested, we were rather ignorant as to what was going on outside. Newspaper every day. We had no transistors in jail. We were truly cut off. Again, you know, as I had suggested previously, out of those 400-some people who were freedom riders, we really didn't know one another. We didn't have visitors, so I really don't know both of you.
You know, I don't recall anyone being prosecuted, but I would add that in prosecuted,
there is
no doubt in my mind that an all-white jury in Alabama would have said not guilty.
Yeah, very good.
At least with respect to the Freedom Rides.
Right.
A follow-up to that, at that particular Rights Act, was there any federal law or lever that could be used to bring charges against those people?
Go ahead.
I think it was, there might have been a law that dealt with voting rights. And so if you could show that someone had deliberately interfered with someone in the attempt to vote, then you could bring a lawsuit against them. But even then, you have to prove that there was an intent to prevent them from voting and that it had occurred during the act of voting. And so if it had happened before they reached the polling place or after they left the polling place, that was not part of voting. So it was very narrowly defined. At that point in time, the levers for federal intervention were very, very few.
I have a question about whether you were personally trained in civil disobedience before you got on the bus.
How should we go through this one?
And nonviolence, nonviolent tactics as well.
In other words, were they wanted to know what to do in case we met some violence. One of the misnomers that went through some training about nonviolence, that's far from real. I know those in Nashville because many of them in Nashville had one of the main characters who did much of the training because of the influence he had from having studied Gandhi and gone to India, that and so Diane asked that, all those, and so they went through much of the training. And we must give that Nashville group credit for keeping the Freedom Rides from not ending because of what you heard on the screen. So in terms of the sit-ins, it was just a matter of you learning how to protect yourself. We taught that a little bit, but some went to much more training than some others. Mine do if you are beaten, how to protect your head and so forth. Well, even with all of someone got pipes and clubs, there's not too much protecting you can do of yourself. In fact, John Lewis, Congressman Lewis, talks about how in South Carolina, guy had beat him with a crate. And that gentleman, years later, came to him in the Congress and apologized for having hit him, which is a tribute to that gentleman. So I don't know of all, but Dion may say, I know you didn't.
Okay, look, there is.
You was on the job training.
Yeah, you heard me say earlier that I had been involved in sit-ins around D.C. I have never had, did not training in nonviolence. And once again, here it comes, Rich. Let's put it this way. There are those of us and those of us who are freedom riders who believe in nonviolence as a philosophy. There are those of us who, as a religious credo. Then there are those of us who, like me, consider nonviolence active. I assure you, if you hit me off of a picket line, if I'm on the picket line, I'm nonviolent. But if I walk off of that picket line, you spit or anything else with me, I'm going to try my darndest to lose my shoe up your butt.
See, that's important because we got to remember that there are individuals on these freedom rides. Atheists, you're religious persons, person agnostics, young, old, you name it. And trying to get all of them to agree to a way of life as nonviolence, he's right. There's some of us who believe that it is a way of life itself. It's a philosophy about living. It's the end lived by. And there are others who saw it as a practical. Now, all of us had to deal with it from a practical sense, because if we didn't, some of us would not be here right now.
Yeah, after all, I mean, look, we had no guns, we had no pipes. They had the military. Let me, bear with me for a moment. I want to take you on this journey. I don't know how many of you have ever seen the changing of the guard at Buckingham Palace, but nevertheless, it's a very organized thing. The bus ride between Montgomery and Jackson, hear me out. Helicopters flying overhead, state police cars and military cars in front of the bus. State police cars and military jeeps behind the bus. When we get to the Mississippi, on either side, on the Alabama side, at least for 100 yards, National Guardsmen on either side of the road. Now, here's the other thing. On the bus with us were National Guardsmen with bayonets. Now, I don't know if we were so silly, or I was so silly, we thought we were being protected. But you know, those men were indeed local people. They had the same prejudices as the people who were trying to harm us. At the state line, on the Mississippi side, replicas of what happened on the Alabama side. Mississippi National Guardsmen on either side of the road for about 100 yards, and state police in front of the bus. That's the same thing. And then to get into Jackson, and then as soon as we get off the bus, we are arrested right away. But my point here is that we thought we were being protected. All through the South, we thought the FBI was our friendly neighbor. Those are the same guys who have to go to the same country clubs as the people who are out in the street trying to kick us in the butt. You know, we were young, we were youthful, we were exuberant. but I think that probably shows you some of the stuff we had to go through.
You know, if I could add just one thing, the Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth, who was in Birmingham, said one-third of the police officers in Birmingham were members of the Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah.
And we now know that the FBI had an informant. Gary Rowe was an informant for the FBI. Gary Rowe was a member of the Ku Klux Klan, reporting everything back to J. Edgar Hoover. Hoover knew what was going to happen before it happened. He did not. And so law enforcement was in bed with the Klan in the South, and when it wanted to be, the FBI was in bed with the Klan. Those are the facts.
I'm curious about your impressions about the proportion of women that were in the Freedom Riders, and did you observe gender differences in their roles and their participation?
Ooh. Well, in terms of percentage, from the reports we get, it was about a third were women. About a third of the Freedom Riders were women. I forget the breakdown in terms of white versus African American and the like, but that was the number that is being reported. About a third were. The other part of the question was not just the number. You.
Were there differences in the, were they leaders? Was their participation different?
Well, surely. Diane Nash comes to mind because the men in the group in Nashville turned over that leadership to Diane Nash to conduct this meeting, to understand what was being held, to make a decision about whether to continue. So that's important to note, that Diane Nash, who's still around.
In fact, it was Diane that the Attorney General in Siegenthal called.
Yeah, that was Diane.
That was the contact between the federal government and the Freedom Riders.
I mean, there were other women that played roles, it would take a long time to say specific what their roles were. But yeah, there were major roles women played. We're also living at a time when the whole patriarchal system was still pretty much the system we worked through in the 60s. And pretty much still today, when you think about it.
Good evening.
Yeah, we have Mike's coming to you next. We have a gentleman in the back, and I'm just going to make a general judgment here that we are cutting the last clip because you'd rather ask questions, correct? Okay. And it's all online, and it's all always playing, so you can see it as well. Gentleman in the back.
Yes, good evening. Understanding that there was a federal law and statute already in place to protect those individuals on their inner... at what point was the actions or the non-actions of the states, cities, and the police departments of the southern states who engaged in the actions that we've seen here on the screen here, at what part was there criminal or considered a chargeable criminal action by the federal government, and how come no one ever pursued any type of legal action towards them for not or impeding you, or even
the ICC?
And initially the Supreme Court decision. So what we have to understand is that in December of 1960, the U.S. Supreme Court says that there cannot be segregation in interstate travel. But there's not yet a federal statute, a federal law that has been passed by the Congress. And so what the Kennedy administration did in May, after the Freedom Rides began, was to petition the Interstate Commerce Commission, the ICC, for an order, which would then go into effect. And the ICC issued this order in September of 1961 to go into effect in November of 1961. And it said that on all interstate Kennedy trains, that there would be a little placard that said seating is without respect to race, color, creed, or nationality. And furthermore, that if a interstate carrier, if you continue to have discrimination at a bus terminal, then the bus line can no longer stop at that terminal. And in essence, the local town would lose its bus service. So the problem was that the Supreme Court decision was not yet being enforced by the Kennedy administration, and that is possible. We have a Democratic president who was talking with Democratic governors. These are his team. These are his guys, and he needs them to get reelected in 1964. Yeah. So the politics is we're not going to charge anybody. We want to turn down the noise and work out a solution. We'll go on and on. But the Kennedy administration made a deal with Senator James Eastland of Mississippi. Yeah. When the Freedom Riders get to Jackson, we're going to protect them. Mississippi is going to protect them. Mississippi is not going to allow any violence to happen to them because we're going to whisk them to jail immediately. And we're going to put them in jail for their own protection, and that was a compromise with evil. What's the Supreme Court decision? We're just going to allow you to put them in prison for their own safety. That's what happened.
Breach of peace.
And breach of the peace means whatever law enforcement wants it to be.
That's right.
So basically, just to piggyback what you're saying, so basically, to the Supreme Court ruling, that's what it sounds like.
Yes, that's what it was. Right. And so it would take the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Because, I mean, what this does is really to light the fire that leads to the Civil Rights Act of 1964. That there will be no segregation in any places of public accommodation. Restaurants, hotels, buses, so that's what it took.
So the other part to that, so it needed to have Congress to sanction, not sanction, but to...
To pass a law.
Pass a law, even though the Supreme Court had passed a ruling.
That is correct.
But the Supreme Court ruling was regarding activity, but it was Lyndon Johnson who signed the Civil Rights Act. Forgive me.
I have like three, that was my first one. I just have two more if y'all don't mind. With the change today with the Supreme Court and changing some of the Civil Voting Rights Act, and watching this film and watching and listening to you three gentlemen about what has happened, because I was a little girl when all of this was going on like this, and I'm sitting here and my heart cries because they have made changes and a lot of their lives for us to be able to be in a Black American, for me to be able to vote and have certain liberties that has just been given to other people without any issue. So how do you feel, all three of you, how do you feel with these changes? Because you put change, and it's changing. And with a lot of the states, with a lot of the laws.
It's really emotional.
It's almost, I feel like they're trying to take us back. And it hurts because this is my country. My grandparents, my parents, they've all paid dues. And you see, there's change. There has been some change. But you know, it feels like they're trying to take us back.
Let's start with the Reverend.
Yeah. I'm going to try to put on my hat here because I sort of feel you. I feel the emotion in a very emphatic way. My message is that, yes, there are challenges to the progress that has been made, specifically as it relates to voting arrangements. There are efforts, if we're clear about it and want to be honest about it, being waged to sort of set us back, keep persons from voting. But for me it is, we got to be diligent in challenging systematic activity to restrict voting, voter IDs and all that stuff. And understand that we got to go to the polls when we vote. So I feel you. And of course, those of us lived through those experiences. Ache in our heart when we don't see persons, number one, register to vote when the site right, and then going to the polls. To the thing that restricts that, that's what we got to be diligent about, challenging. And so I feel you. And
it's all right.
Believe me, we all do.
Yeah.
I'd really like to add to what Reggie has suggested. I feel as if I have failed. I keep suggesting that almost anyone under 40 doesn't know what existed previously. They merely think what is what was. I have failed because, in a way, I think I position that I made my contribution, and I'm kind of laying back on my laurels as to what was done. You can't do that. You got to keep pushing. And you have a responsibility for teaching your kids, your grandkids, about the history of this country, and to make certain that they are not of the opinion that what is, and as has been said before by me and by, I think, suggested by all of us, and by, if we don't watch out, the same thing is going to come back again. So that's, again, what I was talking about. What is past is prologue. You better know your past and respond to it. That's it.
No, and I mean, that is the mission here, is that we want to look at the Constitution. We want to look at the rights that the Constitution spells out and be a part of the conversation about what the Constitution means and where it's at. So we really need to have dialogue about what this Constitution says and what these laws say as well. Respond and kind of look at kind of those pieces of the Constitution and the acts?
Well, you know, I mean, the Voting Rights Act was designed to enforce the right to vote. I mean, and basically back in the 1960s, the literacy tests were being abused to prevent people from voting. Yeah. And so the Voting Rights Act suspended the literacy tests. But today there are new ways that can be used to prevent people from voting, whether it is a voter ID, that's, you know, issued by the state and has an expiration date, or you know, you have to prove, have a birth certificate to be
able
to
prove. And that is actually another program
of
voter ID as well.
Right. So, I mean, again, as the Reverend said, we have to be diligent to know the law and know that we have rights and use them. And the value of programs like this is that, I mean, I agree that most people under 40 probably don't know that the Freedom Rides ever occurred.
Yeah.
And there are people who will never read a book who will watch a movie. And this is why the media is so important. Now, if this was a video game, all the young people would know about it, right? So maybe we need to get this into history as a video game or some kind of app. You can just look at it on your cell phone.
It's like Halo, the Freedom Riders.
Yes, yeah. Right. But programs like this are so important because this is our way to help not only the people here, but you know, younger people who may be in the audience. Know what was done so that we have the rights that we have today. But if we don't fight to keep them, we will lose them.
And what I think is, and I said this in the beginning, the perfect moment, because we do have to wrap up now, is really hearing from the people that can tell us the perspective from history, but also from your first perspective, from your experience. And so you have not, and please in any way, have not failed. You've shared it with this group, with the film, and with everybody, what you have done for all of us. And I know everybody in here is going to hold this very true. This experience for us, we feel genuinely special with all of you. So can we give them a big round of applause?
I usually do a little.
I promise, sorry, I cut you off, but the gentleman in the red vest would like to ask a question, and then we're going to wrap up. You are a grand finale.
Thank you.
Make it good. Okay.
Professor, I believe you're correct that there was, because of the political process and the entrenched nature of the Democratic Party at the time as being the segregationist party in this country, which now has become the Republican Party. So with that as a background, the Kennedy administration was trying to jawbone these people. They were trying to get them to do the right thing, even though they were incapable of knowing what right or wrong was. There was an act on the books called the 1860s Civil Rights Act. And it wasn't until the death of Goodwin, Schwerner, and Cheney that they actually said, jawboning isn't working, and we're going to put the hammer down. And they said, and as a former public official who's now retired, you cannot deprive anybody's civil rights and procedural due process under law, and that has been on the books since 1866. And it was the Republican Party in 1876 that made a deal with the South, the Democratic South, that if Hayes is made president and Tilden is not, we will pull federal troops out of the South construction. And it was with that act, with that decision, that really put the 1866 Civil Rights Act under the covers. And it's not until these freedom rides and the frustration of the Kennedy administration that they turned around and said, enough, when Goodwin, Schwerner, and Cheney were killed.
Yeah. And as you say, it takes the politics often trumps the law. And so we can have a law on the books and people will ignore it for almost 100 years.
Now we begin the anniversary of the Reconstruction Amendments and 3 years of dialogue around those amendments and how it is today. So I think it's a very, thank you very much
yes,
for a very good
you.
Wrap up. No, please, again, we are going to move downstairs to the Kennedy exhibit.
Can I make one quick thing before you leave?
Yep.
What I used to do is a kind of cheering us off.
Yes.
When we leave. What we hadn't talked about is how music plays a role in terms of the incarceration, the arrest. And there were songs that were sung, many of them drawn from Negro spirituals. Words didn't translate, transformed into words reflecting the movement. And I use it dual in that if you don't mind, I'll do it real quickly. I'm a little hoarse, but I think we might be able to work it out. And it just says, oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, and before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. And we say, no more Jim Crow, no more Jim Crow, no more Jim Crow over me. And before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave. Home, and go home to my Lord and be free. That's it.
Again, I'd just like to welcome everybody down to the Kennedy, the Creating Camelot exhibit, and we'll see you in about 5 minutes.
Okay.
You still got the